Just a quick reminder that Ham Radio Now is viewer supported. If you like what we do and you want to help keep us going, stop by our website, hamradionow.tv. Click on our mascot here, Arvin the little piggy bank, and you've got two options. You can do a single contribution, or you can now subscribe for a monthly contribution. That would be cool, but we don't expect it. You can pick the amount that you want. We're aiming for that $10 a year from 10,000 hams. We're a long way from that. And you can type in some comments in your call sign, anything you want to tell us. When you click the add to cart, it takes you to a PayPal site, but you can pay with a PayPal account or with a credit card just by checking out. So any way that you want to do it. And thank you very much. On with the show. Always happens to you. Ham Radio Now from the Orlando Hamcation and the Worldwide Repeater Directory. Who are you?
Bob W2CYK.
And what the heck is a Worldwide Repeater Directory?
Well, you know, for years, it's been, really forever, it's been hard to find repeater information no matter where you are in the world. And now we've spent the last couple of years amassing all the repeaters of the world, as many as we could find so far. We're up to 178 countries, and now pretty much anywhere you go in the world, you can find the repeaters around you. If you got an HT with you, you can meet some local hams.
And where is this output? Where do you get it? I mean, we got the ARL repeater directory. That is a book once a year,
which is U.S. and Canada.
Yeah, and they got the travel guide thing, which is a CD, which is also once a year.
Right.
And then there's information online, hit and miss here and there. But what have you got? Where do I consume this?
Well, you can consume it on any Android or iPhone or iPad or Android pad, and or on the web, or if you have an RT Systems radio programmer. You can use the same email and password that you use on RFinder with their product also. So pretty much any place you want to get at repeater data. For instance, on RT Systems, you no longer have to type in data into the grid. All you have to do is make a quick query from within the software and program the radio. And now it literally takes a minute or two to program a radio for an area instead of an hour of doing your research and typing in, and you know.
Well, I know doing that. Are they using your data or using their data?
They're using our data. They actually connected their software to our system, to our database.
Okay. So, can you describe to me the interface?
It can either find your current GPS fix and find the repeaters around you, or you can override the system and say, well, I'm going to a particular location. I want to see what machines are in that area. So right now we're in Orlando, and one of our devices here is configured for seeing the Orlando machines. And I've got another device. I've got an iPad here that's showing Sydney, Australia, for instance.
All right. And so it will show you the frequency, the location, all the pertinent...
Shows you the frequency, the location, what town is it nearby, what the GPS coordinates are roughly, input frequency, the shift, the tone, etc., whether it's a digital tone or an analog tone.
Do you dig into the D-Star stuff a lot for their call signs and all that?
We do. We have really one of the only good ways of locating D-Star machines in the world. And pretty much anywhere in the world you can find a D-Star machine. If there's a D-Star machine there, you can find it on RFinder.
And how about the other digital guys, the Moto Turbo and the P25?
We have Moto Turbo currently. We have P25 we're working on right now. It's funny that you mentioned that. We were just asked in the last week to incorporate that. We're in the middle of that. And that's one of the cool things about what we do. We listen to the end users. Whatever the end users ask for, we pretty much put it in there. So P25 will be coming probably within a month. We have other linking technologies, like all the All-Star machines are in there. They get updated on a regular basis automatically. We have IRLP gets updated automatically also, as well as...
Can you do anything with Echolink? That's just a huge mess.
Well,
I mean, not a mess, but it's big.
Well, Echolink's an interesting situation, and We're actually working with John over at Echolink to allow us to call his Echolink app on both iPhone and Android, so that if you have an Echolink machine up on the list, all you have to do is hit a button and it will call the Echolink app and connect you to that node immediately. So that should be coming shortly also.
And with your stuff, you can see it. And with the integration with RT software, that will just fill up their database and push a button into your radio?
That's pretty much it. I mean, literally you go in, you click, you know, file, get external, RFinder, and
you give it a distance, a radius.
Exactly. You put in a radius. Have you seen this or something?
No, but I am Mr. Repeater, so I understand how this stuff goes.
That's cool. Yeah, you put in a radius in, and you put a location. You don't have to know the lat long. You just have to put something in, like the Washington Monument space DC, or Eiffel Tower space FL, or...
Now, there's information that you're not going to be able to get, because it's just not published anyplace. That would be the coverage of the repeater. Now, is this a wide coverage repeater, or is it a backyard repeater?
Well, we have some of that information on some machines.
And is this a busy repeater? Do lots of people talk on it, or is it just dead all day?
We don't have that information yet, but people have been asking us to add functionality to let them rate the machines. So
that would be cool.
Yeah, so that's so coming up.
How do you get your information? Because that is notoriously hard. The ARL has deals worked out for decades now with frequency coordinators to supply information.
Well, that's true, Gary. And if I told you all of the ways we got the data, I'd have to kill you. But just say we literally have... 60 or 70 sources of information of information that we've got this data from, and it comes in all different formats. So we've really standardized the formatting of repeater data worldwide. You know, for instance, in Indonesia, their lists were all based on grid squares, and we had to convert that to lat long. You know, in France, the data was in north, and you know, it had NW notations on every or NE notations on all the machines, so we had to convert them over to decimal. So we've formatted everything to be in a very consistent way in a single database, so that no matter where you are on the planet, you can find the machines around you.
One of the other things about repeater directories, any kind of repeater listing, is that they are notoriously inaccurate, because they depend on the information that is supplied by the repeater owner through the frequency coordinator and then on to the ARL. So there's, I'm going to take, you know, pull a number out of thin air, 30% inaccurate, because repeaters have gone off the air, and the users, the owners, don't want you to know, because frequency coordination could be revoked and impossible to get back. So how do you handle that problem?
Well, our end users actually help us keep our data fresh. So, for instance, in an app or on the web, you can go in and make a request for a data change, and none of that goes live until we check the data. Like, we'll look at it, check it on the web, we'll contact the machine owner and make sure that it's accurate. If a deletion is asked for, we'll check to make sure that it's a bona fide deletion request. And I spend quite a bit of time, actually, every week doing that, making sure that all the requests are bona fide and are actually formulated properly. Sometimes people put decimals in the wrong place, or, you know, you're not going to have a 6 megahertz shift on 2 meters. You want 600 kilohertz. So
you'd like repeater owners and maybe even users to contact you and give you information if they look online and see something is different from what they know to be the case in their area.
Yeah, well, just right in the app on both the Android and the iOS devices, you can make a request for data changes. You can go on the web and really change just about any parameter on a repeater, make a request to change. We do not make anything go live until we check it.
Yeah.
And there's a free link that anybody can go to, add.rfinder.net. If a machine is missing or there's a new machine that comes up, anybody can add a machine at any time.
Any cost for all of this, or donations or support?
It's $9.95 a year. When you buy the app, it comes with your $9.95 year subscription, you know, it's a lot cheaper than some of the other alternatives, like the repeater directory or
and more portable and more up to date at all times.
It's portable and up to date, and You know, I mean, how many times have you wished that you could put Travel Plus in the car with you with a GPS? And you can do it. There's a lot of equipment you have to have, a laptop, GPS attached to the laptop, a lot of technology involved. But with these new converged devices, Androids, iPhones, pads, etc., you have all the technology built into one small device, and we've harnessed all that and brought it all together and made it possible.
All right. Jeff, 10-second question, 40-second answer.
No question.
No question?
You have no questions? No.
Understands completely or has no idea what we're talking about.
Do you know what we're talking about?
Yeah.
Thank you very much, Bob. Appreciate you coming by.
Well, Gary, thanks a lot for having me on, and really appreciate it. So.
Yeah, and we'll see. We'll go play with it. And once again, from Orlando, Ham Radio Now, I'm Gary Pierce, Scan4AQ. Jeff, who said nothing?
Jeff Whitty, AC4ZO.
And over.
And out.
73s.